Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Secession and State Creation, What Everyone Needs to Know, by James Ker-Lindsay and Mikulas Fabry. Narrated by Ian Putnam. Introduction. Are all states equal? We live in a world of sovereign states. They are the fundamental building blocks of the international system. And yet this system is in a period of unprecedented flux. Around the world, scores of separatist groups and territories are pursuing independence, either peacefully or through armed force. Not since the heyday of decolonization in the late 1950s and 1960s have the topics of secession and state creation attracted so much international attention. From Kosovo's declaration of independence in 2008, the same year as Russia's decision to recognize Abkhazia and South Ossetia, through to Scotland's independence referendum in 2014, the attempts by Catalonia and Kurdistan to break away from Spain and Iraq in 2017, and the prolonged war between Russia and Ukraine over Crimea, and the secessionist regions of Donetsk and Luhansk, which entered a violent new phase in early 2022, separatism has rarely been more newsworthy. Some see Brexit, the United Kingdom's UK departure from the European Union, EU, as a form of secessionism. Then there are the little-known campaigns, or the potentially emerging ones, such as Ambazonia in the Central African nation of Cameroon, or Tigray in Ethiopia. While most have little chance of success, others are tomorrow's states in the making. Somaliland, Bougainville, Chuuk, and Greenland, all territories, could well be future members of the United Nations, UN. Meanwhile, the nature of statehood itself is being called into question and in a variety of ways. The idea that all sovereign states are truly equal is an illusion. The assumption that the United States, China, and India are the same as the tiny Pacific Island states is a legal fiction. While we say that states are the heart of the international system, many other entities now enjoy extraordinary power and influence in the international system, including the EU, the UN, and even major global corporations. Which wields more international clout, Google or Grenada? Then there are failed states, countries that are formally recognized and part of the UN, but wholly incapable of meeting the demands and responsibilities of statehood. These territories have become hotbeds for organized crime, piracy, and terrorism, and yet we continue to treat them as sovereign states. Why? The power of self-determination. For the past 2.5 centuries, the belief in the inalienable right of peoples to decide their own future has been a driving force in international politics. The United States, the countries of Latin America, and many European states owe their existence to the power of this idea. However, the term self-determination only entered the vocabulary of international affairs in the early 20th century, finding its greatest champion in U.S. President Woodrow Wilson in the aftermath of the First World War. Now vilified for his abhorrent views on race and segregation in the United States, Wilson in his day stood at the forefront of efforts to give national communities their own states. Even today, the so-called Wilsonian vision of national homelands remains the most powerful articulation of the rights of peoples to decide their own political and national destinies. However, it was at the end of the Second World War that the world really saw the notion of self-determination come into its own as the European powers began withdrawing from their colonial empires in Africa and Asia. Explicitly outlined in the very first article of the Charter of the United Nations, the general acceptance of the right of self-determination led to a proliferation of new countries in the decades that followed. When the UN was founded in 1945, it had just 51 members. Today, membership stands at 193. The principle of self-determination is deceptively alluring. While the idea of statehood remains an aspiration for many peoples around the world, history has shown that achieving independence from another national entity, usually known in the parlance of international law as the parent state is fiendishly difficult. Few are willing to part with territory, whether due to cultural or historical attachment to the land in question, the economic costs of losing a province, or just plain national pride. The parent states meet any attempt by a region or minority to secede with fierce opposition. Indeed, these states are often prepared to use force to prevent a territory from breaking away. A string of bitter and bloody secessionist wars in Africa, South Asia, the Caucasus, and the Balkans over the past 50 years are testament to just how far parent states are willing to go to preserve their territorial integrity in the face of a separatist threat. Even if a territory manages to persuade the parent state from which it wants to secede to let it go its own way, the process of negotiating a separation can be arduous. A vast array of issues need to be tackled. These can range from the division of assets through to key decisions over its membership of international bodies. For example, it took a decade after Yugoslavia collapsed in the early 1990s for the five former republics to conclude an agreement on succession covering such issues as diplomatic properties, state archives, and pension payments. As well as stiff opposition from their parent states, territories vying for independence often face strong resistance from other states. The harsh reality is that an aspiring country rarely finds support from the wider international community. Members of that community are often extremely cautious about secession in general, and positively loathe cases where the decision to break away has taken place without the permission of the parent state. They usually punish unilateral secession by isolation and ostracization. This is hardly surprising. Only a dozen or so countries in the world are homogeneous. The vast majority are made up of two or more ethnic or national communities. The fear of separatist contagion is strong. What happens to one country today could happen to their own tomorrow. Any territory vying for independence needs to prove that it deserves to be accepted as an independent and sovereign state. The usually invoked benchmarks for acceptance are the so-called Montevideo criteria. Named after a treaty signed in 1933 in the city of Montevideo, Uruguay, and signed by countries in the Americas, the criteria require a prospective state to show that it has a defined territory, a permanent population, a truly independent government in effective control of its territory and population, and the ability to enter relations with other states. While these criteria are still invoked as the bar for international acceptance, in the decades that followed the treaty, other factors started to gain prominence. For instance, a greater emphasis is now put on such issues as human rights norms and democratic values. Even if a territory proves that it meets the conditions of statehood, the next challenge is to be formally admitted into the select club of recognized countries. This happens in two ways. First of all, there is recognition by other countries. Although legal theorists have long argued that recognition is not necessary, it provides a gateway into the international community. It is the way that states signal they accept the legitimacy of a territory as an equal, at least in formal terms. Recognition is the precursor to the establishment of formal diplomatic relations, which allows for independent states to communicate directly with one another and enter into bilateral agreements. Second, a new state needs to become part of the international system. The ultimate seal of acceptance is membership to the UN. The initial step is to secure a recommendation from the 15 members of the UN Security Council, including the five veto-wielding permanent members, the ultimate in statehood. This is followed by a vote in the General Assembly, which is made up of all the members of the UN. Apart from formal UN membership, membership of other bodies can signal membership of the international community. These include various UN organizations and agencies, such as the World Bank, the International Monetary Fund, IMF, the World Health Organization, WHO, and the International Atomic Energy Agency, IAEA, to name just a few. There is also a plethora of regional entities, such as the EU, African Union, AU, North Atlantic Treaty Organization, NATO, and the Organization of Islamic Cooperation, OIC. Then there are the seemingly mundane but nevertheless important ways that new states join the networks that link the international community of recognized states, for example, by gaining a telephone dialing code or an internet domain address. Acceptance can also be signaled by membership in international sporting bodies, such as the International Olympic Committee, IOC. An emerging new principle of secession and statehood? While the barriers to entry into the international community remain formidable for a wannabe state, there is a growing sense that they are starting to break down. The rules concerning secession that have underpinned international order since the end of the Second World War are increasingly being challenged. The emergence of so-called de facto states is a testament to this. At one time, the legal consensus was that a territory either was a state or it wasn't. If a territory claiming statehood met the prevailing criteria for statehood, it should be regarded as such. Now territories are emerging that have the characteristics of states, self-governing, distinct identity, but are not universally recognized as such. Kosovo and Palestine are both recognized as states by over 100 countries in the international community. Others, such as Abkhazia, Northern Cyprus, Somaliland, and Transnistria, have received little or no recognition. In the years ahead, the international community is likely to face the emergence of more of these de facto states. This has prompted many to ask if the time has come to reconsider the way in which the international community admits new members into its ranks. Regardless of how the debates over the terms of independence and statehood evolve in the future, we can be sure of one thing. Given how much rides on it, millions of lives, the fates of nations, the question of secession and the emergence of new states will remain a key challenge to international peace and security in the years ahead. 1. Statehood and secession in international politics. What is a state? While the concept of statehood has existed for hundreds of years, it is perhaps surprising to learn that the formally accepted definition of a state only emerged in 1933. The Montevideo Convention on the Rights and Duties of States is generally understood to provide the clearest and most succinct legal description of statehood. According to the convention, a state has to have four key attributes. 1. A defined territory. 2. A permanent population. 3. A government, and 4. A capacity to enter relations with other states. In a broader sense, a state is best understood as the fundamental political and legal unit of the contemporary international system. While other actors may exist in international politics, such as international organizations and multinational corporations, the system itself is built around sovereign states as distinct and independent political units. What is sovereignty? At the heart of statehood lies the principle of constitutional independence, better known as sovereignty. Internally, this gives a state supreme legal authority over its territory and population. Formally, at least, a state has the last word over matters of governance within its borders. Meanwhile, externally, sovereignty means that states are considered to be independent political entities. Legally speaking, and by definition, no state is subject to another. All states are juridically equal. That said, they are bound by a package of rights and duties under international law. These include a state's duty not to interfere in another's domestic affairs and the right to expect that other states will respect its sovereignty, its independence, and its borders. Of course, in reality, the situation is rather different. While sovereignty means that all states are technically equal in the international system and under international law, there is obviously a huge disparity between states. The world's most economically and politically powerful states, and its weakest, are far from equal in real terms. Nevertheless, From a formal legal perspective, the United States and the smallest Pacific Island state are equal within the international system. This equality is perhaps best seen in the UN, where every member state has a single seat and just one vote in the General Assembly, its main policymaking organ. And what is a defined territory? Under international law, a state cannot exist without any territory. Defined territory is one of the four main attributes of statehood, and there is no such thing as a country without land. However, what this means in real terms is open to debate. The minimum size of territory needed for statehood has never been established. And the actual geographic size of states varies dramatically. While the world's smallest state is the Vatican City-State, which is just 44 hectares, 0.17 square miles, the smallest UN member is Monaco, at just over 200 hectares, or 0.78 square miles. At the other end of the scale, the largest is the Russian Federation, which, at 17.1 million square kilometers, 6.6 million square miles, is almost twice the size of the next largest state, Canada. The term defined territory also presents other problems. For a start, defined territory does not mean fixed and universally agreed borders. Many countries come into existence with their boundaries still to be defined. For example, the final borders of both India and Israel have yet to be definitively settled, even though they declared independence in 1947 and 1948, respectively. Sometimes, border disputes and issues can arise long after independence. This could be due to a government decision to revive a dormant territorial claim, as happened when Iraq illegally invaded and annexed Kuwait in 1990, arguing that the country had once been part of Ottoman Iraq. Alternatively, border disputes can be caused by natural geographical changes, such as when a river changes course. This has led to boundary changes between the United States and Mexico, Belgium and the Netherlands, and Slovakia and Hungary. Moreover, having a defined territory does not mean that a country's entire territory must be joined or otherwise contiguous. Leaving aside countries that are made up of groups of islands, such as the Maldives, Seychelles, Micronesia, and Cape Verde, to name just a few, there are also many states that are separated from parts of their territory by another country. In formal terms, these external pockets of land are known as exclaves and enclaves. An exclave is a piece of territory that is separated from the main territory of the state, but enjoys borders with two other states or a coastal boundary. One of the most obvious examples is Alaska, which is an exclave of the United States, separated from it by Canada. Kaliningrad is an exclave of the Russian Federation sandwiched between Poland and Lithuania. Nakhchivan is an exclave of Azerbaijan separated from the main part of the country by Armenia, but which also has a land border with Turkey. Then there are enclaves. These are almost the same as exclaves. The key difference is that these pieces of a country's territory are wholly surrounded by another state. One example is Libya, a small Spanish village that lies a couple of miles within France. The breakup of the Soviet Union also saw the emergence of many new enclaves, including the Tajik enclaves in Kazakhstan and Uzbekistan, and Uzbek enclaves in Kazakhstan. But perhaps the world's strangest enclave was Dahala Kagrabari. When it existed, it was the world's only example of a third-order enclave. An Indian enclave within a Bangladeshi enclave, within an Indian enclave within Bangladesh. It dissolved in 2015 when India and Bangladesh exchanged over 160 pieces of territory in a clearly much needed effort to simplify their border. Finally, enclaves should not be confused with what are known as enclave states. These are countries whose entire territory is surrounded by another state. The three current enclave states are Lesotho, which is surrounded by South Africa, and San Marino in the Vatican City State, which are both surrounded by Italy. And does a territory need a minimum population to be a state? As with territory, There is no formal minimum population size. Indeed, the demographic variations between countries are just as dramatic as the geographic ones. At present, around 15 of the 193 UN members have more than 100 million inhabitants, and a similar number have fewer than 100,000. The world's largest country, the People's Republic of China, has nearly 1.4 billion people. Among UN members, the smallest state is Nauru, with a population of around 11,000. In real terms, there are questions about whether formal statehood would be feasible lower than this. For example, the Pacific Island territory of Tokelau, which is currently under New Zealand's control, is considering a referendum on independence, even though it has a population of fewer than 1,500 residents. Officially, and again, the smallest state is the Vatican City State. It has fewer than 800 inhabitants. However, this is rather a special case. Similarly, population density plays no part in determining statehood or viability. Mongolia, with the current lowest density of any country, has just 2 inhabitants per square kilometer, or a little over 5 people per square mile. Meanwhile, Australia, Iceland, Libya, Namibia, and Suriname all exist with around 3 inhabitants per square kilometer. The most densely populated states in the world are Monaco, with 25,300 people per square kilometer, and Singapore, with 8,000 per square kilometer. What does government mean in the context of statehood? The third criterion for statehood under the Montevideo Convention is government. This is perhaps the hardest element of statehood to pin down. No precise definition of government has ever been given. Even the Montevideo Convention was quiet on the issue. However, it is possible to get some idea of what it might mean from the way countries have behaved toward new states in the past. Historically, it was expected that the government of any new state should be effective. This was generally understood to mean that it had to be established by the population of the state and thus be independent of all external authorities, and that it had to control the bulk of its population and territory. However, while the notion of government presupposes some form of an administrative apparatus, this was never meant to be an assessment of whether the government in place could in fact govern well. Instead, it was merely meant to signify whether the population at large was willing to accept the state as its ruler in their everyday lives. If people kept respecting domestic laws, serving in the military, paying taxes, and, above all, avoided active anti-government resistance, in other words, if they collectively demonstrated what was referred to as habitual obedience to the new rulers, then the new government's control was deemed effective. To this extent, effective control was perfectly compatible with ineffective administration, widespread poverty, official corruption, deficient bureaucracy, and a host of other phenomena associated with a weak state. In the post-colonial era, effective control has been largely abandoned as a strict criterion of statehood. This is not to say that the new states that have emerged have lacked effective government. Rather, it was not considered to be a necessary condition for their recognition. Many new states created by decolonization had barely any institutions of effective government. The Congo is a good example. It had just a couple of dozen university graduates when it became independent from Belgium in 1960. More recently, South Sudan, which became independent in 2011, also had very little capacity for effective government when it achieved statehood. Moreover, there is no requirement for effective government to be self-sustaining once a state is recognized. Many countries, often referred to as failed states, have continued to be regarded as states even though they no longer have a functioning administrative system. Perhaps the best example is Somalia. Despite collapsing into a patchwork of warring fiefdoms in the early 1990s, it has remained a member of the UN. What does the ability to enter relations with other states mean? The fourth and final characteristic of a state, according to the Montevideo Convention, is an ability to enter relations with other states, Historically, this was considered to be just another element of effective government. However, within the convention, it was singled out as a separate element, perhaps to try to emphasize the point that statehood was about international legal personality. Today, many observers believe that this attribute should no longer be given the same significance as the other three criteria for statehood. We live in a world in which any number of organizations and institutions can now interact with countries on a very similar footing as sovereign states. For instance, the UN and the EU maintain missions around the world and their officials enjoy diplomatic rights and privileges. Neither are states. Likewise, there are many companies and non-governmental organizations that have extensive contacts with governments around the world. Indeed, they may often be regarded as far more significant actors than many states. For example, most countries would pay far more attention to a senior executive of one of the world's leading technology or energy companies than a high-level member of the government of a small Pacific or Caribbean island state. How many states are there? This is a matter of considerable debate. If we accept membership of the UN as the best and most reliable indicator of widespread state acceptance, there are currently 193 states. In addition, there are two territories that are nominally states but are in a special relationship with New Zealand, known as Free Association. These are Niue and the Cook Islands. Although they are not members of the UN as a whole, they have their own seats in a number of UN institutions, such as WHO. As a result, they have a rather ambiguous status in the international system. Then there are four further territories that are not members of the UN but are widely considered to be states or effectively operate as such for many international purposes: the Holy See, Vatican, Palestine, Kosovo, and Taiwan. In addition, there are territories that claim independence and possess the attributes of statehood but are largely or completely unrecognized by other states. Examples in this category include Somaliland, Nagorno-Karabakh, Transnistria, Abkhazia, South Ossetia, and Northern Cyprus. The exact number of these states, often referred to as de facto states, is unclear as there is considerable difference between scholars and practitioners about whether particular territories meet the necessary conditions for statehood. For these reasons, the most usually cited figure is the number of UN members plus any or all of the others named in the previous paragraphs. Broadly speaking, therefore, there are a little under 200 independent states around the world. What is the difference between a state and a country? Well, both words essentially have the same dictionary definition: an entity with a defined territory, a permanent population, and a government. The term state is usually used instead of country in international legal settings. However, in everyday language, the two words are often used interchangeably. Indeed, both terms are used in this book, if only to add some variation and avoid endlessly repeating the word state. The problem is that this interchangeability doesn't always apply. While the terms state and country are often used to describe sovereign and independent territories, both can also be used to describe lower-level, subnational units. For instance, the UK, a state, is officially made up of three countries: England, Scotland, and Wales. Northern Ireland is also sometimes referred to as a country but is officially classed as a province or constituent unit. Similarly, the term state can often be used to describe a federal unit rather than an independent sovereign state. Hence, the United States of America, a country, is made up of states. To add to the confusion and to further complicate the answer given to the previous question, while the UN has 193 member states, the International Organization for Standardization, ISO, the global body that helps to draw up agreed standards across a wide range of fields, actually lists 249 separate country codes. This includes territories that enjoy considerable autonomy or a distinct identity within an established state, such as Greenland, which is an autonomous dependent territory of Denmark, and Hong Kong, which is a special administrative region of the People's Republic of China, PRC, but are not actually independent. A state can therefore be part of a country, just as a country can be part of a state. Ultimately, how the terms should be understood rather depends on the context in which they are being used. What is secession? Secession comes from the Latin for withdrawal. It refers to the process whereby a territory and its population breaks away from an existing state and either establishes a new country or unites with another one. In practice, almost all cases of secession now lead to the creation of an independent state. There are very few instances in the post-1945 era of a territory that has successfully seceded from one country and joined another. Moreover, few current secessionist movements seem interested in uniting with another territory. One notable exception is, of course, Northern Ireland. Those who want to see an end to British rule over the province support unification with the Republic of Ireland. There is no talk of an independent Northern Irish state. There are two forms of secession, consensual secession and unilateral secession. Consensual secession occurs when the territory breaks away with the permission of the state it is leaving, usually called the parent state. Examples of consensual secession include Eritrea's independence from Ethiopia in 1993 and South Sudan's split from Sudan in 2011. Unilateral secession occurs against the will of the parent state. Historically, the large majority of cases of secession have been unilateral. Most of the cases of secession examined later in this book, such as Northern Cyprus, Kosovo, Somaliland, and Abkhazia, are examples of unilateral secession. Why do countries tend to oppose secession? Although some countries are willing to allow a territory to become independent, most strongly oppose an attempt by a part of their territory to break away. Indeed, even those states that do eventually allow secession will have spent many years, if not decades, trying to prevent it from happening. There are many reasons for this. For a start, a country's borders will usually have an important symbolic meaning and touch on its core identity. Children are often taught from a young age to recognize and draw a map of their country. Even as adults, people are confronted with images of their countries every day, for example, on weather forecasts. Some countries, such as Cyprus and Kosovo, even have the map of the country on their national flags. For these reasons, a change of borders can fundamentally challenge a country's most basic sense of itself. Tied to this, the attachment to a territory may be based on deep-rooted historical or cultural reasons. For instance, it may contain sites of special religious significance. While an emotional or historical attachment to a territory is certainly an important factor, there are many other reasons why states are reluctant to accept secession, even when it might be in their interests to do so, such as to ease tension and foster peace. The most obvious is money. The land in question could have important economic value. For example, it might contain valuable natural resources, such as oil or gas, as was long the case with Scotland. It might be a fertile agricultural region, a widely cited reason for U.S. opposition to the attempted secession by the Confederate States of America. It might be an industrial heartland, such as Donbass in Ukraine, or a financial center, as is the case with Catalonia in Spain. Alternatively, it may have important strategic significance, such as providing access to the sea. This was a prominent reason why landlocked Ethiopia opposed Eritrea's efforts to secede. Then there is the snowball or contagion effect. A parent state may fear that if one part of its territory secedes, others will follow. This was part of the reason Congo put up such strong resistance when Katanga tried to secede in 1960. Again, this is also a very real worry for Spain. If Catalonia breaks away, will this open the way for the Basque country to pursue independence as well? Finally, countries are sometimes reluctant to give up a territory when secession has occurred after a civil war or external intervention. While some may see the logic of letting the land go, especially if it brings about peace, there is often a deep reluctance to legalize an act of forced secession. For many observers, this goes part of the way toward explaining why Cyprus opposes the secession of northern Cyprus, why Georgia stands against the independence of Abkhazia, and why Azerbaijan refuses to contemplate an independent Nagorno-Karabakh. Of course, there are very few cases where the reasons a parent state opposes secession can be reduced to just one of these factors. While one reason may well predominate, it is almost always linked to several other issues. Why do other countries oppose secession? Here again, we need to differentiate between consensual and unilateral secession. In cases where secession takes place with the blessing of the country it is breaking away from, the new state is usually, if not always, accepted by the international community. For example, South Sudan was quickly admitted to the UN following its independence from Sudan.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.